The clouds have parted. Stopped raining. Some blue sky. Nice little breeze. Springtime is almost here. And we're using this time wisely to focus on absolutes. All of these talks focus on absolutes and contrast that to non-absolutes, what some people call duality. Duality is a constant cycling, cycle after cycle after cycle, like a rat on a treadmill. And this works by blaming and scapegoating. It's like this. The ego is attempting to do the impossible, which is make spirit prime creator. What the ego is the mind in the service of spirit, attempting to get this idea to actually be experienced. Spirit wanted to be prime creator. That's always the backdrop of what we're talking about. Now, so ego has to say that it's possible, that the impossible is possible. But how come we're not succeeding? Well, the ego has to use blame. It says one aspect of this effort is obstructing the success. Always, that has to be part of the situation. And then the ego says, but, here comes another aspect to the rescue. Okay, and so we say, okay, we were failing, but now we know why we were failing, and here comes the solution and the help and the rescue from our failure. And here comes the new leadership, which will lead us to success. And so we keep going through these cycles of failure, despair, upset, and then blame, and then new hope, new leadership, new cycle, only again to fail, and then another cycle of blame comes in. We say, we failed because this leadership here, they were wrong, they were bad, they misled us, they couldn't get the job done, and they obstructed success. But here, this new leadership, now, here it comes. Here comes a new leadership. It's that way. You can paint it in broad strokes. However you want to slice the pizza, it's still the same. So there's always scapegoating taking place. Whoever is in charge for a while, they are then demonized and said that they're the ones who have prevented success from taking place. But here come the new ones. Sometimes it's a male-female thing where the men are blamed. Sometimes the females are blamed. There's other blame games. The old people are blamed. The younger people are blamed. Always there's someone getting blamed. Some sector is being blamed. And another sector is elevated. So it's important to see the totality of the situation instead of trying to focus in on just one turn of the wheel of the cycle of existence. Like right now, we have a sector of the world's being demonized and said to be the cause of all the problems. They don't have the right energy. They're, this and this and that. And then there's a new sector coming in who, their energy is going to balance everything out and going to provide the answers, and we're worshiping this new sector. But that is just a small snapshot of a bigger picture of existence where this goes on continuously. Whatever is seen as heroic, hero of the dream right now will soon be seen as the demon of the dream, the one who has actually messed everything up. And then another cycle. So everybody who thinks they're on top right now, there's a lot of aspects of spirit who are identifying with the dream right now, and they're identifying with aspects of the dream that are now on top, that are in charge, large and in charge, and who are righteous and who have come to rescue and save and provide the answers here and give the right energy, the right touch. And it's described in all sorts of flowery spiritual terms. They will find that eventually tables will be turned and they'll be on the bottom and they will be vilified. This continues endlessly, ceaselessly. That's duality. That's dwelling in non-absolutes. The only remedy is for all of this is for spirit to decide it doesn't want to be prime creator. I say that over and over again because that is the only remedy. Bears repeating because it's the only remedy. How one prepares for that choice can differ. But using abstracts is really essential. One has to be able to generalize and not make exceptions. Get to the point where no exceptions are being made, because making exceptions to truth is the ego. That's what it does. Sure, the ego will acknowledge truth, will acknowledge everything, but simply then say, but there's exceptions to it. And of course, here is the exception. It will say, yeah, but it's all going to be transcended. You say, well, it's true, but there's a new truth coming. Well, it's true, it was impossible, but the whole thing is going to be transformed and transcended, and so it doesn't matter. So always an exception to reality, to truth, the direction of creation, which is the prime creator, extending ideas that remain within the prime creator's mind, but also are active and extending on their own. And their ideas also remain with them as they're extended. That's creation. That's reality. There's no exception to reality. Everything is flawless, perfect, never invulnerable. Direction of creation cannot be reversed. Spirit cannot be prime creator. An idea cannot transcend the source of that idea. The effects of an idea cannot transcend the idea. Effects cannot transcend cause, and effects cannot choose which idea they serve. The ego tells you that is possible. And the ego always believes that it can please you, because if you don't like what it's doing, it says, well, it's no problem. I can just decide to choose to serve a different purpose. No, the ego cannot choose to serve another purpose. The ego is not causation. It's effect. Its effect is the dynamic effects of the idea of trying to be prime creator, of trying to forget what we are. In order to entertain the notion of being prime creator, spirit has to fall into deep forgetfulness of what it is, because it's an idea in the mind of God, and spirit knows that and has to try and forget that. And so the ego presents this scenario of deep forgetfulness, where spirit seems to look at all this and say, wow, this is completely different than what I'm used to, but maybe this is the new reality, the new me. I must have come from this is my new home. And of course it's just a forgetting. It's like someone leaves home, goes somewhere deep in some dark jungle, and they live there for a while, and they say, this is my new home. This is where I... And eventually they say, well, this is where I came from. I was born here. I'm a native to here. And they forget all about their true home. They have a deep forgetfulness of their true home. But their true home is still there. It's still absolutely there. It hasn't gone anywhere. Just because one forget something doesn't mean what is forgotten has ceased to exist. And yet we think that must be so. We think that we've somehow burned bridges. We burned all our bridges and there's nothing left. Can't go back. There's nothing to go back to. All this nonsense. None of it's true. None of that is true. We're simply in a state of deep forgetfulness, as if we're sleeping in a bed in our home and having these strange dreams, and we've completely forgotten that we're in our home. And we think that because these dreams don't have anything to do with our home, that somehow our home is gone, vanished. We don't have any home to go home to. It's just like that. Just like that. Amazing. But we have the capacity to imagine and dream all of this. Mind presents all of this. And it's very, very, very capable of inducing this deep sleep of forgetfulness. Very capable of it. And so, to remember, to move towards remembrance, one needs to focus on absolutes, that meaning no exception. No exception to the absolute. In this world, we think we're moving toward absolutes by adopting the no-tolerance policies. But those no-tolerance policies are actually supporting non-absolutes. In other words, they're saying There's zero tolerance towards not adopting a belief in non-absolutes. So that's an upside down and backwards misuse. We all have this craving for absolutes, but we apply it in a way to deepen our sleep of forgetfulness. So what happens in this world is that it's trending towards zero tolerance towards absolutes. That's really what's taking place. It's just a terrible thing, a terrible situation. I've always said that the world is going into a very, very dark place, and it's already there, but it seems to be benign. It's still in a somewhat benign phase. It's kind of like the cancer is there. It's all throughout the body, but it hasn't become extremely aggressive yet. But it's there. It's still there. Now, the world can become aggressive at any point right now. Any time at all, it can become aggressive. I've been pointing that out. And it's very, very important to continue with tremendous preparation. And these videos are here to help with that, because they're focusing very directly, very clearly on truth, on how to be protected, how to find safety from the situation here. The safety comes from being comfortable with absolutes. And not trying to combine the two. It's like on one hand you have the non-absolutes, and on the other hand you have absolutes. Those are the two options. The trap is that the non-absolutes claim that the two can be blended, that the absolute and non-absolute can be blended together and to form some new and better, something that's new and better than both. That's a lie, okay? That is the trickiest of all deceptions, and that is what trips everyone up. If it weren't for that, we would easily see the difference between the two and choose absolutes. No exception to truth, no exception to eternal life, no exception to perfect clarity, no exception to endless riches. See, can't lose any of it. No exception to that fact. But what trips us up is the belief like, by blending absolutes and non-absolutes together, we'll come up with something that's better than both of them. That trips us up. Trips us up over and over and over again, and then we continue these cycles where we get into the blame game of demonizing one aspect and saying they're to blame for the lack of success. And the new leadership is embraced as something that's going to finally be successful. And there we go, around and around and around. Over and over and over. And remember that death doesn't solve it for us, no matter how people are trying to glorify it. Because the problem comes from spirit wanting to be prime creator and the necessity for forgetting what it is. And after death, if one trends towards remembering what one is, spirit will say, wait a minute, something doesn't seem right here. I need another cycle. I need another, identify with another incarnation, because I'm feeling like a huge shift or change, and I'm afraid of it, because spirit hasn't prepared properly to choose a new idea. And as it starts to remember what it is, it will say, wait a minute, I think where I came from has been destroyed, and it's a very dangerous thing. And so it'll suddenly find a re-identify with another body. So absolutely do not put faith in death taking care of your problems, because it doesn't. It may seem more pleasant for a while, but the sleep of forgetfulness is not cured by death. It's only cured by choosing a new idea. New idea gives the overlay of all this entire everything in existence, everything that can arise from the idea of forgetfulness, the idea of trying to be prime creator. Everything is overlaid. all imagination. All dreams are overlaid. And even the dreamer is overlaid. Very simple. And that brings about remembrance of what one is. That's the way. That's the safety. That's the way to sidestep the entire situation. People of today are being told the same thing that people have always been told. The same lies. Never changes. Continually new false hopes that are the same old false hopes, really. That here comes those who know the answer. Here come those who are going to save. Here come those who will bring about this, make everything work. Here come those who are going to raise everything up, etc., etc. But if they're not talking about choosing a new idea, they're not talking about the overlay vision of Christ, they're not talking about that which already is present, it's always been present from the instant we chose to try to be prime creator. This idea of not trying to be prime creator was also present as a choice. The Holy Spirit chose it for us. The Holy Spirit's actually an aspect of spirit. It chose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And that overlay has been, everything has been overlaid from the very beginning. It's always been here. Always there. So there doesn't need to be any progress in the dream at all. Although the dream will ceaselessly present itself as full of progress. So you don't need to stop that belief either. Because all this so-called progress is overlaid too. It doesn't matter what happens in existence. It makes no difference. Whether there's progress or no progress, whether there's transcendence or no transcendence, whether there's ascensions or no ascensions, none of that makes any difference at all whatsoever. Whether one goes up into higher consciousness or falls down to lower consciousness, again, that's all a dream. It doesn't matter, make any difference one way or the other. Whether one is materialistic or spiritualized, masculine or feminine, makes no difference. Zero difference. All of this is a dream of forgetfulness. And what spirit is remains, even though spirit's trying to forget itself. The overlay overlays all of it. Choicelessly. Without any discretion, without any judgment. Effortlessly overlays all of it. There's a lot of activity today on a Saturday. Lots of stuff happening all around, as there is in the world. Constantly stuff happening. Never ending, never stopping. All of it seeming to be consequential. But in terms of the overlay, none of it's consequential. Zero consequential actions. Whether you're living or whether you're dying, whether anyone is doing anything at all, has no consequence to the overlay. Overlay is untouched. Whatever believes it can touch the overlay overlays that. All belief, all concepts, all hopes, fears, strategies, wishes, will, effort, everything. It does not cause any ripple in the overlay. As if you throw rocks in a pond and there's all these ripples, but the overlay overlays all those ripples too. The overlay itself is not experiencing ripples. It's not being disturbed. Just as spirit, what spirit is not being disturbed by the attempt on spirit's part to forget what it is, to deny what it is, to ultimately negate what it is. It's not being affected by that in any way. But we need to see that. First, indirectly, by seeing that everything we've imagined isn't touching this other the overlay. And then from that, once we get totally secure in that and rest in that and completely conform to that, then the next step is to, what would be to, spirit to immediately know what spirit is, that spirit has never been affected, cannot be affected by anything that mind presents. And then spirit will be totally free to be the way that it's always been. So the overlay is ultimately, it is what we would call a remedial step, a rehabilitative step. But it's the only step we need to take. The final step is taken by the Prime Creator itself as far as just an automatic recognition. And these are the teachings that I call it prepping for the times that are here now. Cancer is already in the world. The world is entirely in the grip of it. It's metastasized everywhere, but it has not become super aggressive yet. But it certainly will. Certainly will. And at that point in time, one needs to be able to turn to what one's comfortable with. When stress hits, one reverts to what one is familiar with. Okay. Just like, for instance, someone on the golf course will, let's say a professional, will be try to make change their swing, and they're practicing it, and they have it, they think they have it down. Maybe they even win with it. But then they get into the really, really, really big tournament, the biggest tournament of all, and the pressure's on severely. What happens? They revert back to their old swing. They revert to what they're most comfortable with. So when the situation in the world of zero tolerance towards absolutes, when that becomes super aggressive, as it will, everyone then will be under severe stress, and everyone will find themselves choosing what they're most comfortable with, so they don't have to think about it, so they can just operate automatically. And it will either be focusing on non-absolutes, focusing on absolutes, or focusing on trying to blend the two, which is the deepest delusion of all. That brings severe depression, severe despair, and confusion and stress. The highest stress is the attempt to blend the two, the attempt to be the hero of the dream, so to speak. The ego will tell you that you've been selected to be the hero of the dream, and that to do this you need to be able to blend truth and lies and come up with a something that transcends both of those, which is completely delusional. Truth and lies cannot be blended. And you can hear right now outside here, there's people causing all sorts of disturbances and noise. Reason really, just because that's what they're doing. Just as the world will become very noisy and obstructionist, and you, as you hear, I'm under stress here to continue to speak. As I've said, that under stress we revert to what we're familiar with. So practicing familiarity is the absolute key to success. It's easy to do it in some retreat with all these, you know, support. But can you do it when the whole world has gone crazy and zero tolerance policy is extended in a super aggressive way? You know, in history, as you look at it, the buildup, when you look at situations that have become super aggressive, you have to look at the buildup to those situations very carefully. And you have to see, these are the red flags to look for. And then you can put that template onto any situation in history as a guide to see if those red flags are popping up. And if they are popping up, and enough of them pop up, then you need to really, really, really scrutinize the situation and even conclude that it'll become a severely aggressive situation. And so, in doing that with the situation now, it all fits. All the flags are there. All the attitudes are there. People have literally no exposure to absolutes. Most of the people in the world have zero exposure. And they deep down, they're taught that they have zero exposure because it has no value. They're taught that what they're doing now with this, dealing with a non-absolutes, is valuable and super helpful, and it's the right thing to do. And so in order to justify their use of time, now their focus on where they put all their investments, they will insist that non-absolutes are what has value, and that therefore absolutes, which completely deny non-absolutes, that has to be the wrong approach, has to be simply from a logical perspective. What the problem is that they have a false premise. They're using a false premise. And of course, once you use a false premise, you can apply logic to it, and you'll reach false conclusions, which will seem logical. And during this time, the ego will say, well, if you don't want to go with non-absolutes, you can always be a hero of the dream and mix the two. And that's what will cause the worst problems for people. Usually those who've been on the spiritual path and not quite sure fall into the trap of trying to be a hero of the dream and mix the two non-absolutes and absolutes, put them together and form a new combination that's better than both. That is real suffering, bad suffering. So I want to reach those who are in that situation, who have some spiritual background, some background in various wisdom teachings, etc., and saying it's so important to solidify that, to push further, to amplify the teachings, to get more direct teachings, to get more familiarity. Not just continue on the same old kind of soft sell stuff that doesn't quite, not adamant enough, because the stress that is to come is such that it will easily push one into this position of thinking they need to combine the two. It's kind of like, you know, there's two warring factions and then you think you have to be the peacemakers, but you end up being torn to pieces. Like each side is pulling one direction, the other one side's pulling the other way, different directions, and you're in the middle trying to keep them together, and you feel like you're being torn apart. And then you think that, well, if the people who are focusing on absolutes would just compromise their position a little bit, then that would make your job easier. That's not true, because those who realize that absolutes are the only truth there is, truth is absolute, realize there's no such thing as compromise, that to accept a compromise is to accept insanity, with no reference points to get out of it. There isn't any possibility of combining the two at all. Zero possibility. So to ask those who are focused on absolutes to compromise their position is not a compromise. You're asking them to abandon it entirely. That's not likely to happen. You might think you're making a fair request, but it's not a fair request at all. It's a completely unfair request. But what one has to do is abandon non-absolutes to see that non-absolutes are actually a total abandonment of truth. If one says that there's an exception to truth, even a tiny exception, that one has abandoned truth totally, not partially. There's no such thing as abandoning truth partially. Okay, so these teachings here have to be very helpful for you to hear this. And maybe it should shock you and say, uh-oh, I thought maybe I could be a hero of the dream and that there would be give and take on both sides, etc. But there isn't really any possibility of give and take. Truth cannot be partially true. It's impossible. Lies can appear to be partially true, but partial truth is not truth at all. It's a lie. Partial truth is the lie. Even 99% truth is the lie. That's the big lie. The smaller the exception, the bigger the lie. The smaller the exception that's claimed, the bigger the lie it is. Because it's saying that, well, small exceptions are less an exception than bigger exceptions. No, all exceptions are equally untrue. It's all zero. So in the midst of all this clamor and distraction, which you're hearing here, one has to continue to focus as we are doing right here. It's not that easy. These kids are making a real racket. Just like this world is full of people with an extremely childish type of false belief, unexamined, wishful thinking, that somehow they have the answer, somehow they are able to provide what is lacking. But they're still dealing with non-absolutes. They think that they can manipulate non-absolutes to fill the emptiness, the craving that spirit is feeling. The craving is for spirit to know what it is. That can only be filled by spirit remembering what it is. Spirit cannot be remember what it is by focusing on non-absolutes, by focusing on impermanence, change and temporariness, negation, cannot remember. So manipulating all these effects of existence does not help spirit remember what it is. It's false hope. False hope. It will always be false hope. It will never work. And yet you ceaselessly have influxes of naivete and ego-driven mentation into this world. Wherever you are, you will find that. There will be those who will claim, no, we have the answer. We can manipulate effects. We know how to manipulate effects. We know how to get everybody to pull in the same direction. Well, if that same direction is delusion, that's not going to help. Doesn't matter how you organize delusion, still delusion. Doesn't matter how you organize non-absolutes. It doesn't matter how you organize that. Still non-absolutes, still false. So organization isn't the answer. High level of organization, low level, doesn't make any difference. Both don't work. It's kind of like saying, let's all multiply something times zero at the same time. Let's all coordinate it so we all multiply at the same time. That should work. It doesn't. So we have all this vast mentation in this world right now that is working on extreme efficiency and organizational capacities so that everybody can do something at the same time. You know, we have these special days now where everybody, special hours where everybody turns the lights out at a certain hour, etc. That's the trend of the world right now, the social media and Twitter and Facebook and social media, smartphones, etc., etc., is to coordinate events around the planet where everybody participates at the same time. And it's the belief is that somehow this coordination where everybody pitches in, let's say everybody's praised at the same time, everybody chants a mantra at the same time, everybody lights a candle at the same time around the world. There's a belief that this will have some profound effect. The truth is, and I'm telling this to you so you can hear it right now, it has zero effect. It's like saying, let's all multiply a number, like a number 20. Let's all multiply it by zero at the same time. And then to believe that somehow this has had consequences, has zero consequences. Everybody believing in a lie at the same time doesn't make the lie true. And so the world has been swept up in this false ideation, in the belief of coordinating efforts, in the belief that somehow something consequential and significant is happening, that is somehow going to heal what ails us. Not true. What ails us is this, is the forgetfulness of what we are. And the remembrance of what we are can only come from that which has perfect remembrance from the very beginning. It doesn't matter what we do now, because we have to admit that in the past, this world, the way has been severe forgetfulness, and up and down and throughout history. That's part of existence. That's part of the situation. So no matter what we do now, the past is still part of it. The future is still part of it. It's all one situation. If we've ever died in this world, then death is part of our situation here. If we've ever failed, failure is part of our situation. That doesn't remind us of what we are at all. So it's impossible that this, anything we do on this planet now has the slightest effect of remembrance for us. Because we have to work on banishing all the memory of everything that's ever taken place here. We cannot do that. We have permanent memory of everything that's happened. We're aware of everything that's happened. Everything that's happened has been like recorded. Everything is ceaselessly dying here. Death has already taken place here, endlessly. Just because we say, well, that's no good, we don't like that, it's already happened. Whereas remembrance, the overlay, is perfect from the very beginning. It's always been the overlay. It's always been immaculate. Always will be immaculate. That reminds us of what we are. Only that. Manipulating effects in this world is an absolute folly. So people say, yeah, we had all these wars and all these atrocities in the past, but we're going to fix it all. No. In fact, the happenings in the past are just as much of the record of what's happened here as any fixing could possibly be. In other words, if you get sick, being healed doesn't remove the fact that you were sick previously at all. And so the fact that, so you can say, well, I was sick and I was healed. Well, that doesn't remind you of what you are, because spirit can't be sick. You can say, well, I was dead, but I was raised from the dead. Doesn't matter, because spirit cannot die. So it doesn't remind us of what we are. Physical miracles or happenings in the world don't have no consequence, do not remind us of what we are at all. They just delude us into false hope. The real miracle is the miracle of vision of Christ, vision of oneness, the overlay, the nirvana, not moving, without motion. You see, the overlay is not based on energy. It's not based on nature. It's not based on time and space. It overlays time, space, and nature and energy. It's not moving. There's no process is taking place. There's no movement taking place in it. It's perfectly stable. It's like a gentle overlay, soft, gentle overlay that overlays everything inherently. Some say it's like space, perfect space. But it even overlays perfect space. And it's always been that way. There's no change in taking place in it. There's no healing taking place in it. Because there's no sickness. There's no resurrection taking place then, because nothing is not dead. Nothing's dying. There's no part of the overlay that's different than another part. It's all exactly the same. The overlay, where you are experiencing, it extends to overlay everything exactly the same quality. This is the reminder. See, spirit has to remember, has to have a deep remembrance of what it is in order to free itself from the deep forgetfulness. The superficial efforts in this world that we're told, you know, by the cheerleaders, spiritual cheerleaders here, saying, yeah, do this, do this, let's all meditate, you know, so everybody hold hands around the globe, let's all meditate at the same time, let's do this, let's all sing songs at the same time, etc., etc., etc. This has been going on, it's building momentum. Eventually it will be to the point very aggressive where those who do not participate in this are seen as obstructing the effectiveness of it. The fact is there's zero effectiveness in that. Doesn't matter if every single person on the planet all says some spiritual mantra at the very same time, holding hands and chanting and thinking loving thoughts, that makes zero difference. Will not bring any remembrance to us whatsoever. In fact, it'll heighten the delusion that we're under, because we'll think that it has consequences, that it is bringing remembrance to us, and then we'll think we have to wait for that effect to show up. That's the worst thing ever. Thinking that you've done something, you've already accomplished it, the remembrance, but it's just not showing up yet, so you just have to wait for it to show up. Huge deception. What do you do as you're waiting then, is the question, right? The fact is, it doesn't come. Remembrance does not arrive. And then there's more frustration and more demand to say, well, if it didn't work, it's because maybe some people didn't participate. So you will find everybody will be brought up into this ideology of enforced participation. As you saw in totalitarian societies in the past, for instance, Germany, everyone was required to participate in the mass rallies, etc. Same with other totalitarian systems. It's not an option. You don't like sit at home and say, well, I don't think I'll attend the mass rally, you know. It's not my thing. No, because lack of attendance will be noted, and you will be seen as counter-revolutionary. In other words, you're not participating in the effectiveness of these mass events. But those who realize this is completely futile and even counterproductive, making things worse, of course they don't want to participate. They might participate just so not to get into trouble. But then it makes it difficult. Things get difficult and tricky. So we have seen totalitarian systems on this planet, various places like Germany and China and other places too, where everyone is required to participate in these mass exercises of propaganda, which are really beliefs that what they're doing is empowering them, empowering remembrance of what they are. So there's a very righteous belief that these things are successful. What we have now is a planetary totalitarian system where there will be mass events held throughout the world where people are expected to participate in that, and non-participation is noted as a crime. And that those who do not participate need to be re-educated so that they are now willing to participate. So we've seen this virus, this cancer, creeping into the world over the last 100 years. And now with all the high technology and social media, etc., it's very easy to log on who is participating and who is not participating. And so participation in this is denial of truth. It's essentially saying, I believe that this is going to be successful and helpful. When in fact, one intuitively knows that it is zero, is making things worse. What really works is just each of us choosing absolutes, choosing to be submerged in absolutes. Like someone go wading out into the ocean and then sinking below the waves with like a scuba tank and going below and being submerged in the vastness of the ocean. Just carry that in your imagination, feeling that you've just submerged in this complete, endless, absolute vastness. Totally calm, totally peaceful, totally supportive, unchanging, can never age, can never get sick, and just abiding in that. That is all that is necessary. That is what brings about remembrance for spirit. So just imagine that you are doing that. I am doing that. You are doing that. Each one of us doing that, doing this right where we are. Not demanding any mass rallies to take place. We're just simply doing this, abiding in this. And then others, we're providing examples for others to follow. They simply abide in this vastness of absolutes, to be submerged in it. Just abide in it. Abide in the submergence. That's all you need to do. And others will see that the peace and stability they'll say, ah, that is true remembrance. I know that will work. And then they will be drawn to it as well. That is how it really works here in this world. That is the great guru system, the great system of those who have chosen submergence in absolutes. Abidance in the submergence of absolutes, attracting those who realize, want to go in that direction, realize that this is it, this is really it, the other is not it, it's a fake, it's a phony. That's the real system. That's the system that brings, that really saves. Remembrance saves, deep remembrance saves from deep forgetfulness. Keep in mind that we're, all of us are in this situation of extreme deep forgetfulness. So there has to be extreme deep remembrance. Has to. And so the world is simply wasting its time with all of these events and all of this coordination of people doing things together, thinking that somehow this somehow empowers effects in some way. Doesn't do anything like that. Doesn't remind us of what we are. And so the pressure is really on, more than we know. There's an undercurrent of aggression that one can feel, most certainly, by those who are very, very eager to be heroes of the dream and lead these great rallies that are supposedly going to heal the planet. Heal something. Now, in the overlay, there's no healing. There's only deep remembrance of what we are. The overlay doesn't need to be healed. The overlay is not trying to heal anything at all. It lets everything be exactly the way it is. It doesn't matter how it is. It overlays it. And we're abiding in the overlay, experiencing that. We're not experiencing the sickness and the crippledness and death and negation. Not experiencing it anymore. We're experiencing the overlay of that. That's what brings remembrance. See, all the spirit needs to do is remember what it is. Everything else is a false goal. The idea that we're supposed to heal the planet is a false goal. That's simply working at the level of non-absolutes, level of effects. The idea that we're supposed to heal anything is a false goal. The idea that we're supposed to learn something is a false goal. We don't need to learn anything whatsoever. We need to abide in the submergence into it, of the absolute. Submergence into the absolute. Just abide in that. That's all we need to do. That's it. Nothing more. Anything more is an avoidance of this. That severe disturbance seems to have been moving up the block right now a little bit. It's very tough to talk through it. That was quite a disturbance. Now you see peace has returned. So there will come a time of severe disturbance on this planet. You can count on it. Be very trying. The purpose of teachers here at this point is to help others remain focused on absolutes, on what really works. Remaining focused on the one option that actually works is all important. Remember, not two. It's not a combination. Just one. Abidance and the submergence into absolutes is the one option that actually works, the only option that actually works. Trying to do something with effects doesn't work. It only strengthens our delusion that effects can change the purpose that they serve. That is the most severe delusion, that the idea that effects can choose the purpose which they serve. That comes from directly from spirit believing that it can choose not to be part of Prime Creator, not to be created by Prime Creator. It can choose to serve something else. It can choose to be created by something else. It can be self-created. So here we are believing the ego tells us, oh, whatever's wrong, it doesn't matter, because the effects here can choose to serve a different purpose. No, they cannot. Effects of an idea will always be part of an idea, that one particular idea. Never be effects of another idea. The only way to change effects is to choose a new idea. Cannot take take effects and have them change the purpose that they serve, which is why all the efforts in this world to heal, to make better, to change, are futile. Whatever happens here is only temporary. Whatever healing takes place is only temporary. Whatever cleanup takes place is temporary. Everything will continue to cycle. All constructivity falls to destructivity, which gives rise to more constructivity, which then falls to destructivity. It goes on and on and on and on. That's the dynamic. That's the play of effects of the idea of spirit trying to be prime creator. That play will always be the play. It cannot change the purpose that it serves. Absolutely impossible. So what we must do is choose a new idea. The idea of not wanting to be prime creator, that gives rise to then deep remembrance of what we are. That's the overlay. The effect of that idea is the overlay. Perfect, gentle, unmoving, all-encompassing, completely loving, in other words, non-judgmental, entirely non-judgmental. Overlay. That is peace beyond understanding, that is completely seamless. That is not moving anywhere. Simply settles gently down upon everything, all time and space, and situations in time and space, simultaneously. There's nothing that is not overlaid from the very beginning. You simply choose that, and that brings the deep remembrance. And as you're hearing, that disturbance is, there's no trace of it right now. That was very severe. Yeah. That was tough. But you see, it is possible. We did it. Continued to focus. So it is possible that even during this time now of incredible pressure and demand, the demand may seem to be subtle, but really it's right in our face. It's not to the point yet now where there's jackboots, you know, and people breaking down doors and saying, how come you didn't attend, you know, the rally, so to speak. But it's very close to that. It's a little subtler right now. It's how come you didn't say the right thing? How come you didn't support this? You know, how come you didn't go along with this ideology? How come, you know, in other words, if you don't take the steps that are expected to be taken, you then immediately are a red flag and saying, wow, you're not with it. You're not with this agenda. You're not with this idealistic agenda of getting everybody in jackboot lockstep. It's like an army of healers, you know, everybody's in lockstep, we're all going to heal all at the same time. That is the height of delusion. It's dangerous because it's severe delusion wrapped up in righteousness, in beautiful robes of righteousness. There's no healing necessary. Spirit's not sick. Spirit's never been sick. It needs to be reminded of this fact, that it's never been sick. Spirit has never been born. It's never died. It's never been distorted. We need to see an effect that shows us this. And the overlay is that effect. The overlay is never born. It's never died. It's never been distorted. It's never been sick. I mean, from the very beginning, it's always been that way. We can't claim that about the world. No matter what we claim about the world, we can't claim that. That it's been completely flawless, that there's never been any sickness, any death here. No change has ever taken place here. We cannot claim those things. It's ridiculous. Trying to do so is just, you know, complete waste of time. But the overlay is perfect and flawless from the very beginning. And that is what reminds spirit of what spirit is. Only that. The spirit is not reminded of what it is by any healing. Absolutely not. What was broken is now fixed. Does that remind spirit of what it is? Absolutely not. That helps spirit forget what it is. The more one focuses on what is healed, the more one forgets what one is. Spirit was never broken in the first place, so the idea of being healed is complete forgetfulness. Spirit needs zero healing. Nothing has to be fixed. more we focus on fixing things, the more deluded we are. The more we focus on making things better, the more deluded we are. The more we focused on curing anything, changing anything, making anything better, the more deluded we are, the greater is our forgetfulness. Spirit was created perfect from the very beginning. It's an idea in the mind of God. No need to be made better, no need to be fixed, no need to be healed, cured of anything, no need to learn anything, no need to go through any process, none of that. All of that deepens the forgetfulness. That's the fabric of forgetfulness, all of that. So what you're hearing now is non-dual talk, absolute talk. It's different, very different, isn't it? It's literally pointing out that the so-called righteous actions of the world actually deepen the delusion. The belief that we can make something better deepens the delusion. Deep remembrance isn't making anything better. It is simply remembering what already is. Remembering that Spirit already is perfect. And of course, remembrance can't be direct, because it wouldn't be remembrance then. It would be simply experiencing. So in order to have remembrance, there needs to be the overlay of what we use to try and forget. This is non-dual thought. This is a kind of talk that points one in the right direction. And it might be shocking. It should be a bit shocking, because you say, whoa, you know, there really is a choice. There is a perspective that views things differently. It doesn't go along with the crowd. It doesn't go along with the notion that if we all heal together, that somehow this brings about something great for us, profound for us. No, it brings about profound forgetfulness. And forgetfulness is not profound. It's despair. Ultimately, it ends up in despair. It ends up in a feeling, a horrible feeling that is projected outwards, and then blamed. Others are blamed for this feeling. If one doesn't have the wisdom to realize where it's coming from, it's simply false belief, false efforts, rejection, a belief that prime creator, that we have already left the mind of God. That somehow we've already managed to be separate from the mind of God, and therefore we cannot be helped that way. We cannot just simply realize what we already are. We have to come up with something better. We have to establish ourselves as prime creators. See, if we haven't left the mind of God, then all we need to do is remember that fact. It's all we have to do. So, by refusing to simply remember that fact, it means we believe we have managed to separate from the prime creator. But it's not true. That's simply wishful thinking on our part. We can imagine all sorts of symbols that separate from other symbols, and then believe that this is evidence that we have separated from prime creator, but we're not a symbol. We're a living extension of the prime creator. We cannot separate. It's impossible. So all we need to do is remember this fact. We don't need to do anything else. And again, remembrance of this fact takes place only from that which is flawless and perfect from the very beginning. Not from something that was separated but now has been returned. That is forgetfulness. Not from something that was really great and then fell into all sorts of troubles and separated and then was healed and brought back. That is forgetfulness. None of that happened. Spirit never separated from prime creator. Spirit has always been flawless. And Spirit has to remember that. Has to remember the truth. It's never gone on any odyssey. It's never been beaten up. It's never been bruised. It's never been broken down. It's never been lost. All these things are just dreams. So spirit doesn't need to pay any attention to the dream. Dream won't help the spirit remember anything. Spirit needs to pay attention to the overlay. It needs to abide in the submergence into the absolute. Like one simply floating beneath the surface of a vast ocean, endless, infinite ocean, completely blissful, calm, peaceful, seamless ocean. Just floating there, very quiet, very relaxed, abiding in the submergence into the absolute. Only that brings the deep remembrance. Only that. Nothing else. No manipulations of energy brings that. No pyrotechnics of energy bring that. No subtle attunements bring that. Nothing else that we call spirituality brings that. Now, there may be all sorts of ways to prepare to move closer to abiding in this emergence into the absolute, but this abiding in this emergence in the absolute is what has to take place. And that comes about by choosing not to be prime creator. That has to take place. That is the actual remembrance, the deep remembrance. Everything else is just a prepping, a preparing. One can prepare in various ways. But let's not mistake the preparation for the actual abiding in this emergence. Those are not the same. The means are not the end. So there's no reason to argue about, well, does this work or that work, or this is a different path or that a different path. No. Goal is always the same. One goal. Maybe different ways to climb up the mountain, but just one mountaintop. And we're talking about the mountaintop now. We're talking about that you cannot make any exceptions to it. So we're focusing on the goal and saying you must reach this goal. That's all we're saying here. It's not any particular approach here, except to just say you must cast aside what doesn't work and choose what does work. However you can build up the resolve to do that is up to you. But focusing on absolutes is kind of a all-encompassing teaching that reaches all different approaches, meaning that you can't make any exceptions to truth. It's impossible. You must have the deep remembrance of what you are. That must come about. Whether your path is service, or the heart, or a reason, right discrimination, right knowledge, all these various so-called paths, etc. The facts are still exactly the same, no matter what path one takes. Facts that are being laid out here are exactly the same for everyone. Seems like we've weathered that storm. That was really quite a storm, wasn't it? I thought it was a beautiful, you know, beautiful near spring day here, lovely, in the Bay Area here of California, and start taping, and then suddenly these kids just go berserk over there and just make the biggest racket. I don't think they could have made a worse racket if they tried. And now it's subsided into great peacefulness here. That was quite a trial. See, I didn't say anything to them. I didn't go out and say, hey kids, can you tone it down a little bit? Now, forget it. Simply continue right focus. Don't try and stop the world from doing what it's doing. That's futile. What would have happened if I had gone out there and said, hey kids, knock it off. The parents, they would have complained to the parents. The parents would say, who are you to, you know, tell my kids what to do? And before you know it, there's all these hurt feelings and anger and upset. And the whole thing is you've lost focus entirely on the absolutes. Instead, I simply ignored it as best as possible. So simply ignore what the world is doing, what the world is going through, the racket, the totalitarianism, all that stuff. We know it's there, of course, but just ignore it. Don't fight it. Don't curse it. Don't tell it to stop doing what it's doing. Don't tell it to tone it down, etc. That's futile. That will cause you to get swept away. And we don't want that. Definitely don't want that. Don't throw away your clarity. Increase it. And if you're making progress in clarification, you're able to withstand all that racket because you know that you're doing something very valuable. And it's not worth it to break that off and quit it. So don't quit paying attention to clear, adamant, non-dual teachings. Guidance and truth, which is satsang. Satsang means sitting and listening to the highest truth. Not just non-absolute talk about how we're going to heal something. That's not truth. That's not the highest truth. That's not truth at all. Sure, one can stitch something back together and call it healing. That has nothing to do with the remembrance that we need. So, abiding, satsang means abiding and listening to the highest truth, meaning real truth, actual truth, truth without exception. Pointing out there's only one way to remember what one is. That is by choosing a different idea, the idea of not wanting to be prime creator, and abiding in the submergence into absolutes, into the absolute, meaning truth without exception. Meaning overlay without exception. Everything is overlaid. Overlay doesn't make an exception to what is overlaying. Without exception. Flawless from the very beginning. Always flawless. These are absolutes. The overlay is absolute. No exceptions to it. So abide in the absolute, meaning abide in the overlay. And be aware that there is no exception. That's all. Be aware there is no exception. It doesn't make exceptions. It doesn't say, oh, that person over there, I'll overlay that person, but not this other one. These people are making a racket. I won't overlay them. No. No exceptions. That brings remembrance. Only the overlay has this. The most righteous people in the world who claim to be the most loving people, they always are making exceptions. Qualifications. It's ridiculous to think that somehow we can cultivate a loving attitude that has anything even remotely close to the overlay. That's the ego telling us to cultivate attitudes like a loving attitude. It's a complete waste of time. The overlay is already present to choose, and it is perfect love. Only perfect love reminds us what we are. It's completely flawless. It has always been that way. The whole idea is that we need to cultivate a loving attitude. That automatically is saying that we have not had a loving attitude up to this point, and we need to change something. That doesn't remind us of what we are at all. So it's futile to develop anything, to work on our attitudes, to work on our personality. That's futility, and it causes severe delay. Because we expect results that don't come from it, and we wait for those results. You don't need to do anything at all with what your personality and your attitudes. The more you strive to do something with them, the more deluded you become. Just know that whatever attitudes and personality happen to be hanging around with what you call your persona, those will be overlaid equally with all other attitudes. That distinction. So the overlay is perfect love. It's an absolute. Only absolutes remind us of what we are. So here again, we have a sharp distinction between non-dual truth and dualistic false belief. Any effort to change anything deepens the delusion, rejects the overlay, rejects the means of true remembrance of what we are. Right now, the overlay is overlaying everything right now. So what is it that has to change? Nothing. The overlay will always be overlaying everything. So what needs to take place? Nothing needs to take place. And nothing needs to not take place either. Doesn't make a difference either way. Still the same. The overlay is the same, perfect from the beginning. Always perfect, unchanging, not getting better, not becoming more loving, not becoming more non-judgmental. It's already perfectly non-judgmental, perfectly loving, already from the very beginning. It's always been that way, always will be that way. Just like Spirit's always been an extension in the mind of God, always has been that, always will be that. There was no interruption of that. No gap at all. None. There's no gap in the overlay. And simply we abide in that overlay, be submerged in that overlay, and we notice and realize there's no gap. There's no exception being made at all. And then that it is the reminder. That is the reminder of what we are. That is it. That's it. If we're not being reminded in that way, we're not being reminded at all. We're being falsely led astray. Half the reminder is that there is no exception. There is no gap. Never has been. Flawless from the beginning, now, and for endlessly. No change. That is the reminder, remembrance of what we are. Anything else is non-remembrance. And when we employ other means, we will wait for results. And we will, as we're waiting for results, we will reject choosing the overlay because we say, no, I want to get the results that I put my effort into. I'm expecting those any moment now, so I don't want to choose the overlay right now because I'll miss out on those results. There are no results because there may be all sorts of effects that take place, but those effects do not bring about remembrance for us. So we have to be very careful when we look at this, because we're waiting for effects to take place, and they certainly will. However, those effects will not bring remembrance. So we have to ask ourselves, what are we waiting for? That's the question. What are we waiting for? Yes, we're waiting for something, clearly. But is it worth waiting for? Is it worth it? So now we're getting to the nitty-gritty. Is it worth it? I'm asked, you know, what is this waiting? What are we waiting for? The effects from all our efforts to arrive. New situation, you know, something to change, maybe a little better situation, different situation. But are those effects worth waiting for when the overlay is right here to be chosen? Will those effects that we have worked on to generate, will those bring about the deep remembrance? And how could it possibly do that? Since the very fact that we're trying to change something means that it wasn't right in the first place. Whereas the overlay is unchangeable. There's no need to change it. It's never changed. And only the unchangeable reminds us what we are, because we have not changed at all either. Truth cannot be changed at all. Truth is not waiting for some effects to take place. So, here we are, waiting for some effects to take place, and choosing to wait for that rather than choose the overlay. That's simply the situation we're in. And we need to look at that, continually focus in on that, bring it into focus like under a high-powered microscope until we see the folly of that position. Others might say, oh, how unfortunate you didn't wait for the effects. If you just waited a little longer, you would have been the author of something wonderful. You'd be the hero of the dream. And we can say, well, that may be so, but that doesn't bring about remembrance of what I am. So it's useless, because the only goal there is for spirit is to remember what it is right now. It's the only goal. If spirit falls into forgetfulness, there's only one goal. That's to choose deep remembrance. That's it. And no matter what effects take place in this world, that won't bring about the deep remembrance. So as far as reaching the goal, it's useless. It has no utility. Zero. Nothing. So zero. Whatever arrives in this world is still zero. If it's not the overlay, it's still zero. Even a guru arriving is still zero. But to the extent that the guru reminds you of the overlay, that's useful. It's utilitarian. It has some value that way, but not ultimate value. It's not the remembrance itself. The teachers are not the remembrance itself. They're a reminder of what has to take place, that you have to choose to abide in the overlay. It's a reminder of that. But it's not the abidance itself. One must do that oneself. One has to choose that. So don't even wait for the guru to show up. The ego will always say, the guru is about to show up. And that'll keep you waiting endlessly. The ego will say, no, don't use the overlay. The gurus are going to arrive tomorrow or next hour. They're on their way. Well, the whole purpose of the guru is to get you to choose the overlay. So if you can choose the overlay right now, you're doing exactly what the guru wants you to do. So what do you have to wait for? So that they can be there when you do it? They don't need to be. The overlay is aware of itself. Doesn't have to be a person there for you to choose the overlay. What are they going to do, applaud? You don't need any applause. Once you choose the overlay, you don't need any applause. Don't need any recognition. You simply abide and recognize there's no exception to truth. That's all that one is interested in. So don't wait for the guru to show up. Don't wait for the savior. Don't wait for the avatar, the saint, the sage. Don't wait for anyone to show up. That's the ego tricking you into waiting. You might be ready to do it and then think, well, the ego will tell you, no, some guru is going to knock on your door. And you got to be ready for that. And if you're in a state of submergence into the absolute, you won't be able to grant them the right hospitality, blah, blah, blah. Do you really think that if a guru shows up, that somehow they're going to be offended if you don't come out of your submergence in the absolute and in the overlay? No guru would be offended in any way by that. In fact, they'd be delighted that you pay them no heed. In fact, the guru not showing up might be saying, the guru saying, look, pay me no heed. Choose the overlay. Choose to be submerged in the overlay and abide in that submerged.